So I have to thank you for this very warm welcome and your friendliness. For me, crafts actually has been an everlasting joy. And from Japan, I think my aesthetic instincts were honed at a very young age of 8. Because Japanese at that time, of course, it's now a highly industrialized nation, and they have these oases of crafts, and they have craftspeople who have been declared national treasures of the country. But you gave a craftsperson a matchstick, and he would peel aside two sides of the little matchstick so that the black part was like the flower, and then two leaves would be formed. It was so beautiful. It was a bit like the insect over here. A tiny stick can give you a beautiful artistic flower. And there was so much that was like India. The grass mats, which is so familiar to me as a Malayali in Kerala, and the shibori, the tie and dye, everything seemed to resonate, but at a very high aesthetic level. At that time, of course, so many years ago, it was a part of their lives. And after all my travels all around the world, and when I finally landed in Kashmir, I found that what was happening was, it was a very grim time in Kashmir. It was in the late 60s, and it was just before the Indo-Pak first war, a few months before. And so either it was all very gloomy, or there was no electricity, and there was hardly a bookshop in Srinagar, and we were all Cambridge and Smith College, USA returned people who couldn't find a book to read. It was all very sad and depressing. But I would spend time going into all these little dirty gullies and finding these craftspeople making the most exquisite things, but yet, in a way, letting their work get degraded, because there were hardly any tourists. And so the tourists bought rubbish. They didn't know any better. And if something was of bad quality, they never came back to say, well, look, this was not good, it broke or something. And so everything was at a very shabby level. And from those days, I started sitting with them and trying to get them to link up with the rest of the country. And I would spend the winters in Delhi bringing with me little objects which they'd made, which I thought could catch the Delhi market, something new. So that's how it started, and it was, one could see that they could not read and write. They had no access to anybody but fleeting tourists. And there was so much potential, but they lived in the dirtiest little alleys. And this is something that I continue to find even today, that we make beautiful posters for these festivals of India, showing our craftspeople with lovely turbans sitting against a mud hut. But the condition when you go to those villages was terrible. They either didn't have electricity, they were covered in flies, or you go to a gully in Firozabad, for instance, where bangles are made. So a very strong social instinct or political instinct. Politics is not all just elections and votes and me, me, me. It's really, if you go down to it, just the same as social work or just the same as genuine religious work, where you really put yourself all out to work for the benefit of somebody who needs it. My journey into politics also had two reasons. One was to be able to articulate at the political level the needs of craftspeople. And I didn't fight elections ever, because I thought it's better to work in the organization and be responsible for getting 20 or 30 MPs elected, because then I'd have 20 or 30 voices in parliament being able to speak out about weavers committing suicide in Andhra Pradesh or whatever. So this was what actually brought me into politics. So there was always actually parallel streams which sometimes crossed. I used the political platform for my craft work, and my craft work always continued, because that seemed to me the very basis of why I should do public work at all. And it's also, I think, a political outlook has given me an understanding of what craftspeople need, and how you can actually link what Dilip mentioned as the aesthetics, the creativity, and the empowerment. The idea of having a heart, having this kind of a program, setting up Dilli Heart, was to get craftspeople directly to the marketplace. And once they could do that, to have the courage to do that, many things happened all at once. One, they could be freed from the clutches of middlemen, who sometimes exporters would go and give them 5 rupees for something, which then would be sold somewhere else for 500 rupees. And this poor person would never know that where that thing was going, how much it was being sold for. And they sat helplessly at home, sometimes not even eventually getting paid for it. I have seen situations in Badohi, in the carpet industry, women working, five women working in a dark room weaving a carpet which would pay them collectively, say 12 to 1500 rupees, which they had to therefore share between five people. Some of it would get cut because they'd say that it was imperfect. If they managed two carpets a month, they maybe got 600 or 700 rupees to feed their families, and this is women-headed households. So from that kind of a situation, how do you get them out of it? How do you create a sense of empowerment? And what I did when I went to study Badohi, the carpet industry for women, I found they told me that about 700 women had gathered from various villages. And they said, this is the first time in 50 years anyone has come to ask us about women, about what are the problems of women who work at carpet weaving. And so we gathered, we had all the officials there, we had a whole pile of problems and complaints and darkhast and nivedans and all that happened. And when I was leaving, some of the women came forward and gave me beautifully woven little grass baskets. And they just said that this is only for our love, we make them for ourselves. These baskets are used, the small ones for mithai, the big ones for wrapping saris. And when we go with our daughter in a wedding procession, all of us carry baskets with the goods and goodies that have to go to her future family. And that's all we make it for. So I thought that why should they not give a value to their lives by giving a value to that basket? So we created two programs where we went again village to village. I took baskets from all over the world for them to see. And I said, this is what this basket is costs in Sri Lanka, here in the Philippines, so on, so on. Now your baskets are so beautiful, do you want to learn to make them for the commercial market? So they all agreed, very old women, and we got a sort of small stipend for them to learn. The men brought them on cycles every day to these little workshop areas, and the men would go to sleep under the tree and wait for their women to finish the workshop classes, quite happy doing that because their women were earning. A couple of weeks of that, we created a range of most beautiful baskets, which then I said, okay, you come to Dilli Haat, I'll give you a stall and come and sell your baskets for 2 weeks. So from that 700 rupee a month earnings with the carpet weaving, they came to Dilli Haat and in 2 weeks they earned 17,000 rupees. Then I put them into a stall at Suraj Kund Mela. In Suraj Kund Mela, in 10 days or 2 weeks, they earned 45,000 rupees. Then I called, Mulayam Singh Yadav was at that time the chief minister, and this is where the usefulness of being in politics comes in, at least one foot, was that I asked him to come and inaugurate an exhibition of their work in Delhi, and he was kind enough to actually leave the assembly session and come in a helicopter and inaugurate that exhibition, and in 3 days they did 2.75 lakh sale. Now they get orders for 10 lakh rupees a year. And in that little area where you first come in, there's a boy as soon as you enter on the left. He is the grandson of that family and he brought a few baskets. The rest of his luggage still hasn't arrived. It will come on Monday. But he's practically sold out all his baskets, and that's the famous Badohi basket, which actually nobody knew 5 years ago. And we had a little press conference for these women who make the baskets. And they're very shy, head covered and all the rest. And I said, just say to people how you feel about all this. And the one sentence those women said to the media was, "Ab sab kuch hamare haath mein hai." That to me was what empowerment meant. That now everything was in their hands. So there was this simple, beautiful, skilled work. We used to go and work in the desert areas of Kutch. Beautiful embroideries, every community doing different kinds of embroidery. And there was a man who used to come along giving his wife's work. So I said, we don't want to deal with the men, you are not embroidering. I want to deal with your wife whom I can then explain how to change the colors, how to make something new. He said, you can give me 1 lakh of rupees, but I will not bring my wife in front of anybody. So we said, okay then, go home and don't get any work from us. So he watched and he saw other village women coming in hordes, coming and taking work, getting money, sometimes anguta receipt, and opening bank accounts. So finally, he decided to relent and brought his wife along. And we discovered that she was the most beautiful woman, half his age, and no wonder he didn't want to show her to anybody. And then, from having her cover her head and him walking ahead, and she carrying the parcels and the baby, quite soon, she was walking ahead and he was carrying the parcels and the baby. But these were nice, silent, gentle changes that happened. And they didn't stop covering their head. So that's what I like to say about Indian empowerment. You don't have to change much. You don't have to throw off the veil and burn your bras. You can do keep to your own tradition and keep to your own identity. But those really deep and subtle and necessary changes can happen through this kind of craft. And even the young men that you see, I hope you notice that a lot of these people here are young men. And yet you will hear many people say, oh, we don't want to carry on with this craft, our young boys don't want to do it. Yes, it is happening. Varanasi, for instance. The young boys prefer to do nothing in Narega. They prefer to sit on a power loom and let the machine just go doing karak karak while they are reading a film magazine or watching a teeny TV hooked to the loom, cricket match. But there are in touch among the weavers, young men of 25 and 30 sitting at a meeting just 2 months ago with me, with a 2-year-old child on his lap, saying, hum bhi ye kaam karenge aur ye bachcha bhi bada hoke karega. So it's a question a lot of the time of how you motivate the attitudes of the craftspeople, and it's not necessarily a horrible oppressive system. Because how is it that this system works somewhere and doesn't somewhere else? So this is how I try to empower them, by first of all gaining self-respect. If they have self-respect, then you will respect them too. Then they have to respect their own work. A little project I'll share with you. Lots of craftspeople have over the years come to me and said, hum anpad hai, hum gareeb hai. And with this kind of work, can you imagine feeling such a lack of self-worth in having to say a thing like that? So rather than feel sorry for them, I would get angry with them. And I say, how dare you say that? You look at what you do. Nahi, humko angrezi nahi malum aur computer nahi malum. So I would say, if you, what you produce on your loom is 100 times better than some silly fellow sitting on a computer and clicking out some rubbish. So you don't have to do that. And look at our Indian languages. Of course, learn English, but what about your own language? Can you read and write? Then they say, padhna likhna kya fayda? What job will we get? So I said, don't look for a job. Learn to read and write and bring that back into your own work. So we started this project called Akshara, Crafting Indian Scripts, in which I cooked it up in my head for about 6 years. I was thinking about calligraphy all the time and looking at all the beautiful wall writings we have. Look at West Bengal, all the communists. Every wall, they paint so beautifully with all the klachalo stuff. All of that made for visual beauty, design, aesthetics, creativity. And that we brought back. I explained this is what is calligraphy. Many of them can't even pronounce the word. And I said, if Persian calligraphy, Korean, Japanese, Chinese is all over the world, here we have 22 official languages, 700 and odd various languages. Why is it that we are still pining for English? Why do we not look at our own scripts? And finally, we did a project with 21 craft skills, 70 odd craftspeople, 15 languages, and we created 150 exhibit quality products. These products came out so beautifully that after showing them at the Habitat Center in Delhi, we were invited, with the government paying for it, to show it in Egypt and then finally at the UNESCO headquarters in Paris, where many, many Chinese delegates and representatives and visitors was so thrilled, and here we all are feeling, oh my God, China does everything better than us. And the Chinese visitors were saying, how marvelous your varied crafts, how much you have, how many skills you have. We have all become mechanized. And how interesting to see how an Indian alphabet is written. We haven't even realized that this is something we can charm people with. And this project has gone very well, and I'm hoping to show it in other parts of the world, actually just to show off what India can do with just this idea of combining literacy, calligraphy, craft and script. We have a publication, then we created a film with Bharatanatyam, yoga and calligraphy. How the movement and flow of a body is the same as a flourish of the pen of calligraphy. How you have to take a deep breath and internalize it and then do it all in one go. We can combine everything in our culture, and when we try to put it in pockets that, you know, industry is such and such and make in India means only industry. This is everything, not only make in India, but I believe sell in India, more than chasing export markets. Everything is possible economically. So I would ask Vijay to please get all his own thought cells working and lots of all the young economists under you whom you inspire to seriously think about this sector as a really economic power engine, because all this stuff, and in Dilli Haat I have sold a turnover between about 180 craftspeople. We have done a turnover in 2 weeks of 9 crore rupees. But there is so much money which then directly goes back to the village and which creates purchasing power for all the industrial goods that everybody is trying to sell. So when you have those industrial goods made in India, then here are the people who are going to buy it. But for them to be able to buy it, they are also skilled. They don't need much skill development, all these catchwords of today. Skill development, training, livelihoods, make in India. All of that is right here. And all of it is ready. They have not asked anybody to pay for training. They've all trained their own children, generations. They don't need much infrastructure. So there is so much potential that we have to think about that I think this sector needs a lot more serious attention, and anybody working in any field can find something relevant to do for it. Thank you very much.